So we will attempt the Facebook Live. Good evening, everyone. Thank you again for joining us this evening for what is a powerful conversation. I think a most relevant topic. We've done this before. We don't think anyone is doing it as well as us, but that's a credit to the people, subject matter experts, people with the knowledge and the expertise to talk about this topic. Very relevant topic. And so my name is Melvin Coleman. I'm the president and CEO of the Atlanta Black Chambers. I'll be getting out of the way here in just a minute and turning it over to the host and just anticipating a great conversation. Let's learn and let's strategize and then let's take action. So welcome to the State of Black Farmers. Dr. Diane Adoma, I am going to turn it over to you. I've identified several of the panelists, so I think we're going to be okay from that standpoint, but I'll turn it over to you to greet everyone, and we'll get the agenda going. Thank you.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Melvin. And I don't know if you mentioned that you are the president of the Atlanta Black Chambers. I didn't hear that, so I want to give you your... You did.
I think I did.
Okay, well, I'm making sure.
Thank you for... Yes, ma'am. Okay.
We'll come back, circle back in a minute, but now I want to bring on Marquis Tate. Before I say anything, give due respect to both presidents. Marquis is president of Advancing Black Businesses. Marquis, are you on?
Yes, I am here. Good early evening. All right, I'll take it from here. I want to just tell you a little bit about Advancing Black Businesses and take you on a, just a very, very brief history tour of Black farmers. But welcome to the State of Black Farmers. We're going to have a great discussion tonight. We have some great experts, I call it, and entrepreneurs that want to hear some great information. But Advancing Black Businesses is a nonprofit organization that educates Black business owners and Black consumers on the best ways to understand the political process and really how to get heavily engaged in the process. We do that in a few different ways by, again, educating Black business owners, determining what best matters by surveying our Black business owners and Black consumers. And we work with local, state, and federal agencies and officials on building that political base and building that strong political base. And we also do that by research and data. What we're here to talk about is really the original entrepreneur, I call it. The original entrepreneur in our community is a Black farmer. Just to take you on a brief history. Today, just 1% of the farmers in the United States identify as Black farmers, according to the United States or the USDA. These numbers are down from 1 million Black farmers over a century ago. In 1919, Black farmland ownership peaked around 18 million acres. That's an average. It's really 16 and 19 million acres from the research I've seen, but that was about a 14% of the agricultural land. A century later, everyone, 90% of that land was lost, mainly due to discriminatory practices and in some cases, violent practices. And I'm being nice about that, y'all. Even though Black farmers now account for only less than 1% of the agricultural land, Black farmers are drawing the strength, listen to this, for the long history of agriculture production as a strategy to address food insecurity and improve the health of our local Black communities. Everyone probably remembers in 1997, Timothy Pickford, a Black farmer from North Carolina, sued the USDA for racial discrimination, which created the Pickford Settlement. Black farmers from 1983 to 1987 were denied loans and for contributing to the decline in the Black farm ownership. That settlement is in the amount of around $2 billion. And fast forward to recently, the Inflation Reduction Act, the Discrimination Financial Assistance Program, which has been all over the news media starting last month. And those recipients of those, which are mainly Black farmers, 23,000 individuals who have land or had farming or ranch operations are going to receive between $10,000 and $500,000 assistance. And that's a nearly average of about $82,000. So that's only one part of it. But I know we got to get going. I'm going to put some information in the chat about those links to actually how to apply for that assistance. Also links of the Pickford case, if you want to look more into that. And links of even a Black agenda centered around agriculture in the Black community. A Black agenda, we want to talk about those Black agendas because this is an election season. But hey, Dr. Doma, I'll turn it back over to you. Thanks a lot. Looking for a great conversation.
Thank you, Marquis. And now before we get started, I do want to recognize the chair of the Agricultural Committee, which is Henry Jones. And before I let him speak, I want to recognize the chair of Governmental Affairs. Hayden Singleton is online. These events are in part successful because of our governmental affairs chair. He's doing a phenomenal job. Thank you, Hayden. And then we're going to go to Henry to say a little bit about the chair of the Agricultural Committee.
Dr. Adoma, this is Hayden Singleton. I am not the chair. I'm the co-chair. We have a chair. Her name is Montina Frazier, and she is doing an amazing job in her position. I just want to throw that out.
Thank you for that clarity. I got to learn this on my committee when y'all tell me who's on there.
I appreciate you very much.
I appreciate you. Thank you for the clarification. Henry?
Yes, good evening, everyone. First of all, I want to say thank you to the Atlanta Black Chamber for allowing us to have this conversation. There's several reasons we're on this conversation tonight. One is we had a conversation with the hemp and cannabis farmers several months ago back in April. And there was so many people asking for a continuation. So we decided to go ahead and continuate and help, you know, continue to share this information. The other reason is, you know, we've got so many farmers out there and so much land, as Ms. Marquis just talked about, we've lost so much land to Black farmers. We need to educate our farmers as to, you don't have to go out there and get a plow and a mule and get behind it no more. Modern technology is really helping farmers, and we're trying to show you some new techniques and ways that you can get out there and farm and actually make a good living. So, and we're going to talk about, like you said, some of the things that I just went to an event. They talked about the discrimination. I'll talk a little bit about that later on in the story about how the money was actually divided, how the farmers felt about that in a room full of Black farmers with the USDA 2 weeks ago. Thank you.
Thank you, Henry. And before we get started, we have a dynamic panel this evening. You're going to learn so much about the state of Black, the state of the Black farmer and the state of Black farming. Before we start, are there any elected officials or candidates who have joined us this evening? If you're on the line, the Atlanta Black Chamber would like to recognize you. If you just give your name and the seat you currently hold, or your name and the seat you want to hold. Okay, we'll come back. If some of you had issues with your microphone, we'll come back around to you. So I'm Dr. Adoma. I'm VP of Governmental Affairs for what I call the best chamber, the best Black chamber in the state of Georgia. This evening, we're going to talk about the state of the Black farmer. Farming is important, you guys. As Marquis have already mentioned, I've read today where the Black farmers are to receive $1 billion in reparations after years of mistreatment. They're going to receive this money from the USDA. Raise your hand. We need to monitor that. We need to make sure that that money is actually administered to our Black farmers. But what I found interesting, and Marquis may have touched on it, there are less than 3,000 Black farmers in Georgia, according to the USDA. And in 1910, Black farmers owned about 16 million acres of farmland. 16 million acres in 1910. Fast forward today, and you look at the numbers, how much do you think they own today? And that's acres of land. It went from 16 million acres to 2.9 million acres from 1910 to today. So there's a tremendous Black land loss there, and we need to talk about that. And the panel is fully prepared to talk about why that is so important. The other thing I want them to talk about is the age, the average age of the Black farmer across the U.S. The average age of a Black farmer is 57.5 years. We need to bring our young people in the fold and to help them to understand that farming can be very lucrative and financially profitable. But if you're 57.5, young like me, then it's important to know that farming can be hard work even with all the technology today, but it does have a great investment. So we do want to talk about the state of young people with farming, with STEM and STEAM programs, community gardens, nutrition. If nobody's farming, we don't have any food. So keep that in mind. And we need to grow our own food. And we're going to talk about that tonight too. So the panel, I believe all of them are here. And I'm going to start with our first panelist, if they could just introduce themselves and the firm or the organization that they represent. And then we're going to go down and we're going to have an engaging conversation to talk about the state of farming. This is an engaging conversation. So if one conversation builds upon the other, we can always make sure that you're getting your questions answered. So if you're on the line, I would like for Handy Kennedy Jr., owner of HKJ Ranch LLC to introduce himself. Take 1 minute.
My name is Handy Kennedy. I'm fourth generation farmer in Cobbtown, Georgia. I am the co-founder of Agro Unity. And basically, Agro Unity is a coalition of farmers and where we are engaged in helping farmers become vertically integrated. My personal opinion is that when my great grandfather and father farmed, they were vertically integrated, where they basically grew their own seeds and basically took those seeds and grew their crop and then basically took those crop directly to the consumer. I just really truly believe that we have forgotten about vertical integration. That's why economically a lot of Black farmers are suffering because they incorporated middlemen into the whole process in the supply chain where we basically grow a good crop and basically get devalued most of the time. And then that same person that devalued it basically take that same commodity and basically revalue it once he own it and build generational wealth. So AgriUnity is really about teaching our farmers how to get back to vertically integrating on their farm where basically they can sell their commodity directly to the consumer or customer. So that's what we strive to do is teach the farmers in AgriUnity how to become vertically integrated. Thank you.
Thank you. And we got Dr. Elias Jackson Jr. If you could just introduce yourself, take a minute or less, because we're going to circle back for our conversation.
Yes. Hello, everybody. My name is Dr. Elias Jackson. I'm Senior Vice President of ViraFarm Enterprises. It's a biopharmaceutical firm located in the Texas Medical Center. Our firm focuses on developing precision-based radiopharmaceuticals targeting cancer, neurological disorders, and infectious disease. To that end, we have over 50 patents in the area of innovation and technology, focused on biopharmaceuticals. The goal here is to introduce innovation, technology, AI, and robotics to agro-biopharmaceuticals. And to that end, we partner with different farms, entities, schools to accelerate their operations in that space. We are also partnered with the largest robotics firm in the world, as well as the hospital systems in the Texas Medical Center, thus creating a pipeline for those entities, those farmers, to really be able to integrate into the pharmaceutical space by working with large institutes like MD Anderson Cancer Center. Again, thank you for having me here, and I look forward to a wonderful discussion.
Thank you so much. And now we'll hear from, let's see. Do we have Dr. Wilson?
Hi, yes, I'm on. Unfortunately, when I start my video, it says you have to let me in.
It seems like you're in the room. Hey, yeah. Hey, can you double check?
It says there you can't start your video because, okay, good, we're on. Hi, everyone. Thanks for having me. I'm Dr. Latricia Wilson. I am the co-founder and vice president of the Black Farmers and Agriculturalists Association out of the state of Florida. I'm also the president of the Southern Farmers Hemp Association, and I'm actively involved with the Black farmers receiving a medical marijuana license down in Florida. So I'm looking forward to a great discussion on a number of these topics. And today I'm going to basically talk about the state of the Black farmer, more of a generalized overview. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Wilson. I think you've been with us the past 3 years.
Last two.
Yeah, I remember. Okay, well, we'll circle back in a minute. Let's hear from Frederick Cawthon, president of Hemp Alliance.
Good evening, everyone. It's a pleasure to be with you all. As Dr. Adoma said, I am president of the Hemp Alliance of Tennessee. That's the trade association here in the state, headquartered in Nashville, which obviously trade association, we're focused on not only educating consumers, but pursuing legislation that benefits our producers and businesses within the state in regards to hemp. Additionally, I am vice president on the U.S. Hemp Roundtable. I lead the Minority Empowerment Committee, which is focused on how do we get adequate laws in place that support our minority communities. And if to learn more about either one of those organizations, Hemp Alliance of Tennessee is yourhat.org, and then go to hempsupporter.com for the U.S. Hemp Roundtable. Thank you, and looking forward to the tremendous amount of discussion and dialogue we can have. But a one key call out is making sure that we ask the right questions to leave up out of here and take action.
Thank you very much. We appreciate you being with us tonight. Next, we have Elaine Smith.
Is she in the room?
I'm checking. Okay, we'll circle back in a minute. And then we have our young farmer, Amon James, CEO of Amon Farm LLC and Foods of the God LLC. He's our young farmer on the panel tonight.
Good evening, everyone. As you heard, I'm CEO of Amon Farm and Food of the Gods. I went through the program of Amon Farm to basically teach young farmers like myself or people in general on different ways you could create added value products or businesses in the farming industry. And so that's what we teach all together. But yeah, that's it.
Thank you. We're looking forward to hearing more from you this evening. So you can see we have a very, illustrious panel tonight who, my God, I don't even feel like I'm adequate to moderate this, but thank you for asking me. Let's dive right in. This is going to be an engaging conversation. The title of this is The State of Black Farmers. And I just want you guys to just engage. I'm not going to call on you, but sometimes I will, and I will ask a follow-up question. Based on your experience and your expertise, what would you say is the number one challenge that you're currently dealing with in the farming industry in your particular state or your area?
Help or money?
I had to smile on that one.
He's right.
I know.
Go ahead, panelists.
Yeah, I was going to jump in there and say that obviously, you know, the elephant in the room would be capital to not only fund businesses, but operating capital as well. Because even if you pull together enough funds from friends and family and potential investors, because really there is no marketplace for banking at this point when it comes to hemp, just still certain concerns, Safe Banking Act hadn't passed. And so getting access to capital. And then I would say number two is the marketplace, having the connections and the team in place to go build clients, generate revenue, right? Mm-hmm.
Any other comment on the challenge, or is it safe to say that that's the challenge across the board with farming in general? I don't want to put words in your mouth. Can you elaborate a little bit?
Yeah, I would have to agree. Lack of access to markets. That's one of the biggest challenges that I think a lot of our farmers have is the lack of access to markets. Most of the time when you go and try to access certain markets, they'll basically tell you, well, you don't have the volume or you don't have the quality to sell at our particular market. And so if we can gain access to certain markets, or as a matter of fact, just create our own markets would be even better. So I would have to agree access to capital and also access to a larger market for our farmers to have access to.
Dr. Dumb, I'd like to also add in. Can you hear me? Yes.
Yes, we can hear you.
Yeah, I would say, in addition to that, there's also an extreme amount of training that needs to take place in terms of what's required to enter into markets. And oftentimes that's the key of knowledge that Black farmers don't have in getting into markets. For example, a third party audit, you know, which is very difficult to develop, you know, a standard operation procedure, and it's very difficult for farmers to follow it. But in order to get into larger markets outside of farmers markets and CSAs and grocery stores, those are very attainable. But once you talk about quantity and getting into wholesale markets, there are certain requirements that make you eligible and prepared. Nobody wants to get sick when you are, or want to make anyone sick when you are providing food for the consumers. However, you know, leafy greens, lettuce, we all heard about different types of bacteria that they have to pull and recall. And that has a lot to do with the farmer understanding where the contamination points are on the land. So there are different permits and certifications and requirements before you go to market. We want to go to market because that's where the money is, right? Diversifying is what we preach here at Farms to Grow, not just selling at a farmer's market, not just selling at a CSA. In fact, if you're selling at a farmer's market, in order to make a considerable amount of profit, you have to really sell at several farmers markets. Out here in California, we have, you know, other nationalities selling at, you know, 10, 12, 15 farmers markets. And according to our statistics that we've studied, farmers work full-time jobs and they don't have that kind of time and availability to be spread so thin. So, you know, diversifying and then having the proper certifications and permits in order to get into larger markets.
And Dr. Smith, you're on the West Coast in California, right?
Yes. Oftentimes people confuse me with Dr. Myers, who is the co-founder of Farms to Grow. I am not a doctor. I may sound like one, but I have not done the work to become a PhD. So just Elaine Smith is fine.
I made you an honorary doctor tonight. How about
that? Okay, thank you.
Exactly. But you guys, I just got to note that we got a lot of people online. Actually, this is a sold out program tonight. So we need the panel to share their social media usernames in the chat. If you guys can put that in the chat as soon as possible so that I know we're going to run out of time and we want to make sure people know how to reach you. But thank you, Ms. Smith, my honorary Dr. Smith. Thank you.
Thank you. And yes, I am in California. Yes.
Yeah, because I want to do some, I want to ask some questions on comparisons on how the farming industry in California is uniquely different from Georgia. We're going to come back around to that. You guys, I mentioned earlier about the percentage of farmland having a dramatic reduction from 1910 through today. So Blacks owned more land in 1910 than they do today as far as acreage. Like I said, 16 million to 2.9 million. I need your thoughts on that. We want to know what's happened.
Yeah, I'll take that on right quick. It's Dr. Wilson. Yeah, we've lost over 90% of the land that we used to own. And this is due to a combination of things. Obviously, the discriminatory practices, lack of access to resources that you just heard, legal challenges, and also economic pressures that disproportionately affect Black farmers. Not only losing the land affects the farmer, but it affects our communities. So it's a community thing. So it reduces economic mobility, wealth accumulation, and obviously community investment. So those are some of the things that really affect, you know, this number of losing 90% of our land.
Anyone want to expand on that?
Yeah, I actually, I know I'm jumping a little late, but there's so much to talk about, you know, with that. When we look at the 2022 census and we compare that, we don't even have to go all the way back to 1920. We can just look at 2017, compare 2017 to 2022, and there's a land loss of 4%. You know, and so the question is, well, why is there a land loss? So Farms to Grow, we've surveyed the farmers here in California, and we know that land loss is largely contributed to, you know, not having access to funding, you know, in order to get equipment and access to loans. And so that's a large share of it. But the other side of it is that some of the statistics, I did pull down some of the statistics from some of our studies. And what we found that 98% had a primary source of income or full-time job. 98% of the farmers who are farming, right, they already work a full-time job. So when are they really farming? You know, they just have Saturday and Sundays to farm. 3% work with at least one family member, 25% a landowner, 75% lease, 85% don't trust the USDA, 90% don't have a farm track number, 80% are growing less on less than 20 acres, 90%, we already talked about this, sell at farmers markets and CSA and don't even file the Schedule F. And then we have 98% that don't have the proper infrastructure, you know? And so when you look at all those things together, then it really paints this really beautiful picture of us understanding why there's such a decline. There's a decline because Black farmers don't have the proper and the necessary infrastructure, funding, in order for them to sustain themselves, you know, to gain any kind of economic relief, you know, so I'll just stop there and let someone else answer, but I certainly have a lot to say about why that decline happens, you know, sales, lack of trust in the USDA. If you're not trusting the USDA, if you don't have a farm track number, you're not eligible for some of the funding that they have, you know, for the farmers. So there are a lot of pieces that make up one full component and why that number is continuing to decline. And our goal here at Farms to Grow is to create pathways and bridges where we can slow that decline. I mean, we're talking about, you know, urban gardeners whose numbers have increased, and the USDA are asking the urban gardeners to now fill out a farm track number, where I'm here to tell you that's going to skew the number. And the next census is going to show that there's an increase, you know, but we're talking about land ownership. I mean, urban garden is fine, you know, but they're limited to what they can do because of limited access to land and funding.
I'd like, we're going back to
Madam Moderator.
Yes.
My name is Bryant Harrison. I'm a farmer in Southern Greenville County in South Carolina. I've heard a lot and enjoyed all of it. But as a farmer, I literally I'm sitting here listening to you guys with dirt under my fingers.
Mr. Harrison, I hate to interrupt you, but we have a planned panel, and what we are going to do, what we are going to do once the panel has completed their session, we are going to open up the floor to the people. But right now we have a planned program and it's timed. So in all due respects, if you can hold that in comment, and once the panel has finished, we will let you back in to have your comments made on the floor. So
thank you very much and I apologize. Yeah.
No, that's okay, I understand, but this is a planned program. Even though we haven't practiced anything, the itinerary is planned. So once we get to the end of it, Mr. Harrison, we will bring you back on the floor to ask your question or make your comment. Thank you. We'll go back to the panel. I think I was mentioning, I've heard it three times this evening, infrastructure, and I've heard access to capital. It seems like nobody on this panel is arguing with those two definitely being a challenge and being an obstacle to being able to advance in the farming industry. Now, ladies and gentlemen, we got to talk about how do we create that access to that pipeline of capital? What can we do? And how do we get access to the infrastructure that we need badly that we don't have? I'm going to stop there because I want you with the expertise to answer that.
Doctor, I'll jump in on that. I can only share what I'm doing. Not saying it's the perfect way or the only way, but here is one path that I have taken, one leveraging the access or the platform that I have as a Black man in roles on both a state organization where I'm the president, and then at the national level where I'm a vice president and on the board of the US Hemp Roundtable. To dive in real quick on, okay, what is the roundtable? The reason that we have the ability to legally grow, process, manufacture products from hemp is because of the US Hemp Roundtable, which back starting in 2016, started working with Senator McConnell, who was majority leader at the time, and worked to basically get language in the 2018 Farm Bill that legalized hemp on all US soil as it is written. Having the opportunity to be in that space, Vice President over our Minority Empowerment Committee, one of the things that, you know, everyone is aware, we're waiting on the next farm bill to get across the finish line. And luckily for us, in my case, it was delayed because I partnered with Dr. Floyd at Tennessee State University, who was doing, Corey Floyd, who was doing a research paper, a dissertation on the impact of to the social impact of Black farmers in the industrial hemp industry. And that has now been published. And what we're now embarking on is connecting him with the legislative team at the US Hemp Roundtable so we can see from the results of where we reached out to farmers throughout the Southeast, including Mr. Henry Jones and others that he pulled in from surrounding states to provide their feedback from the Black perspective. Now we want to take those results and see how we can fit those either into buckets that have already been defined as the roundtable's agenda that we're pursuing for this now 2025 Farm Bill, or do we create a brand new bucket? But, you know, to sum it up just on that is, it's us getting, you know, I always love when we can coalesce around like the Atlanta Black Chamber, where we can come in as a group in space and talk about common issues. But then one key additional thing is we got to be at those other tables where the decisions and the influence is being made. Because when I am there, I always feel like I'm representing, it's a million people behind me, that whatever I can get across that finish line is getting ready to have impact on the million people that's behind me. And so I work both channels is what I try to do. Even at the state level, one of the projects that I'm working on right now is, 2 years ago now, under the Climate Smart Commodities Grant that came out from USDA, Secretary Vilsack, where it was, $3 billion at the end of the day. My organization partnered with the University of Tennessee, Tennessee State University, HBCU, and Tennessee Department of Agriculture. When we had those teams at the table, and it was time to say, okay, who's going to be the primary co-PI on this project? I immediately said of why it was an advantage to have the HBCU, because the whole grant was not just about climate smart commodities, but it also was focused on underserved community, we are fit, we fit in the category of an underserved community. We should have at the spearhead, the spirit of this tip should be an HBCU to drive this program. And so if you Google it, Climate Smart Commodities, you'll see Tennessee State run one was awarded right at $5 million. So that's another way of sitting at that table and being able to influence the decisions that are being made.
That's an interesting point. Now we have farmers here on the panel who are from all over the US. I'd like for someone else to chime in because I think what he just said was extremely important. And I would want to ask a yes or no question. Do you think you've gotten your share of those billions and billions of grant dollars that have been distributed by the USDA?
I think I'll chime in from Florida, and I would definitely say no. I mean, there's a number of reasons for that. And like he said, just to kind of feed on what Frederick said about we need to have policy and advocacy. We need to make sure advocating for more transparent and equitable distribution of federal aid. We need to push for systems that monitor and hold them accountable for that. And in terms of grants and subsidies, sometimes they can be so complex when they're applying that the smaller farmer may not have the knowledge or assistance to navigate through that process. So we need to make sure they simplify those processes so we can have access to that money. So basically, to wrap this up, we need to be at the table when they're deciding where the money's going. And then we need to be on the other side when the money comes, because we're not definitely getting that. There are a few people, what I found most of the time, even with the Pickford lawsuit that was mentioned earlier, most of the money went to the attorneys. This last night, I mean, I got a check 2 weeks ago, and it was less than 8% of what I asked for in terms of discrimination. I was like, well, I'm not going to turn it down. It was free funds. But, you know, my losses and things that I experienced was much more than what they'd given me. So, no, we're not getting the same. And I think all of my farmers in Florida and all over the United States would say no.
Well, Dr. Wilson, I'm going to hold you there because I'm going to come right back to you. Henry and I were just talking about a few weeks ago about the complexities of filling out all this paperwork. Most of the time, the Black farmer just gets stuck. The paper is very difficult and complex. So in your opinion, if a program was available through like our chamber that would be able to help the Black farmer get through some of the grant paperwork, do you think that would bring some value to our Black farmers nationally?
Yes, definitely. I think anyone that can help, and that should be the role of a lot of things like the associations, like our association, the chamber, government agencies, all of those folks need to help the farmer when they come in for this assistance. And I agree, definitely. I mean, I think there's going to be a lawsuit for this last one because the application was 32 pages long. And you're asking a farmer to do that. And a lot of them went to attorneys when they didn't need attorneys. And lo and behold, the attorney got one third of that amount, which makes no sense because it was a simpler application, but it was 32 pages, which made it scary. So definitely, I think that's an avenue, that's a resource that the Black farmer can go over to the chamber and they can help me fill this out. I think they would jump on it.
Dr. Dormer, what I was just going to suggest too is we have to think in collective terms, because if we are a group, that's going to better leverage resources for, say, if the Atlanta Black Chamber has grant writers available, okay? We're going to get more bang for our buck if it's not just one farmer, but we have a collective of farmers that are benefiting off of that. Because when we talk about these grants, I just recently worked with the city of Nashville on the EPA's community change grant. That's a $20 million grant. It's not going to one farmer. It's going to go to a collective. Well, and this is not even a farmer related project. It's more so affordable housing and other things within Black communities here in Nashville. It's going to go to multiple minority agencies. it's not just one Black nonprofit in the city that's going to receive that funding. It's multiple across different segments or sectors that they're focused on, from renewable energy to housing, you name it, right? And so I use that same blueprint to say, from the farming community, it's us coalescing a group of farmers in, and then it's the Atlanta Chamber taking advantage of. There are billions and billions of dollars. I'm probably right now talking to three groups on separate different initiatives, all focused on minority, and they're not all agriculture related. So I'll stop there.
I like to kind of add, just kind of, you know, just on the tail, that there's two sides that in how we see it. One side is the policy side that you all are mentioned. And then the other side is, how do we deal with the representatives at the offices on site? You know, we constantly get feedback that, for example, we sent one of our new farmers to get their farm track number from the SSA. And once they arrived there, the representative asked the farmer and his wife, who sent you? Instead of welcome, you know, instead of how can I help you? Their first question was, who sent you? And so I'm saying that to say that there's still a lot of racist, you know, antiquated thoughts and people that are still in positions in the office. And what one of the tactics that we started on our end was to, you know, oftentimes when you have to email the NRCS, the FSA, back and forth in communication, it's typically just one farmer kind of back and forth in conversation. And what we found, and you guys are welcome to take this on, is that every farmer that's under Farms to Go membership, they add my email address to all the communications to let them know that somebody's watching, you know, how you are communicating and treating this particular farmer. And in that case, when the couple went in and the representative said, who sent you, they called Farms to Grow's office, and I happened to be there to answer the phone and politely told them that this is why they're there. And then they continue to ask, well, are they getting a farm track number because they're interested in selling goods? It's like, that's not even a question they should have asked at the office. And people think California is so liberal, but it really isn't. You know, when it comes to politics, it really isn't that liberal. The people, you know, a small percentage of the people are very liberal here. But however, the NRCS, USDA, FSA, what one farmer is experiencing in Tennessee, Georgia, Alabama, we're also experiencing that here in California. But a tactic that does work is to, number one, know which programs that are available, so you're informed when you're talking to them. And so on one hand, we're talking about how can we help the farmers today. On another hand, when it comes to the farm bill and policy, that's going to happen over a period of time, right? But today, farmers need help today. They're in survival mode today. I was looking at some of the percentages of farm loss throughout the country, and it's declining in all the major cities and states where the farmers are. So I would say, number one, you know, have someone from an organization begin to be CC, not BC, but CC on an email, somebody with some level of authority, because they will research and see who that person is, but somebody with some level of authority, and then hold them accountable, because there is a percentage of that money that's supposed to be allocated towards Black farmers. When I looked at the 2022 census, you know, they didn't even mention California farmers in the 2022 highlight of the census. And so if you're not mentioning us, how much money are you really allocating to farmers if you're not mentioning us in the census? So, you know, we have to hold them accountable. We have to, if you see something, say something, even though, you know, we may not want to, but that's the only way that we're going to create change is, you know, if we see something, say something, hold them accountable for the funding that is there to assist.
And Lane, I'd like to add on to that. We had that problem a few years ago, but what we did as our organization is I met with them, met with the office, met with the state boss, the big boss, and said, hey, the Black farmers are watching. Our members are going to come. Black farmers are going to come there, and we expect this. And they told us they will keep a record of when they come, and they have to be satisfied, and they will survey them. And we checked with our farmers, and that has worked well. We haven't had many problems anymore. Initially, we were having the same issues that you were having, but we notified them, and we haven't had to CCE or BC anyone.
I was thinking, as both of you were giving your comments, this is a safe platform, so we're going to keep it real, okay? Racism still exists. Now, some people want to walk around and say, no, you know, but this is a safe platform to voice our opinions respectfully, and it does exist. And I think the accountability piece is grossly missing, because there are things that are in place to solve some of the problems, not all of them, but some of them, right? Those things are in place, but they are dysfunctional. They're not working. And the revenue and the access to capital is not coming to you. So I'm going to try not to get too emotional. But I am so happy that you guys are on this panel tonight, because what I want to say, someone just sent a text to me, and they said in the past 5 years, the U.S. lost 7% of all farms. The U.S. lost. While black folks lost nearly 13%, the highest decline among all racial groups. Now, that came from the press. I want you guys to comment on that.
You know, I mean, that's real talk. I think it's a combination of what we're all saying, you know, holding the USDA accountable, not relying on the USDA solely for the funding. You know, diversify. And what we do here, Farms to Grow, yeah, we do rely on USDA for funding, but then we look at foundations, we look at donors. I mean, really just by diversifying how your revenue comes in, and then also being more of a public, having someone to be more of a public voice, you know, about your programs and the work that you're doing. But, you know, I think, you know, you don't want to rely so much on the USDA. There are other foundations and sponsors who are willing to fund different projects, especially if we're talking about climate smart, we're talking about carbon sequestration. I mean, these are all things that regenerative farming, these are all things that Black farmers, honestly, what we do, right? But they put a new title on top of it to make it seem like it's something new. But, you know, cover crop, crop rotation, I mean, all that kind of stuff, you know, Dr. George Washington Carver is, you know, talked about that, taught that. And it is part of our tradition and legacy to continue that on. But what they've done, the USDA have now come out with this regenerative agriculture certification, which really basically says the stuff that we've been doing, now you got to be certified in order to enter into markets. And so it's just things like this that you have to continue to watch and say, you know, oh, we're already doing that. We don't need to pay. It's $340 per acre in order to be a regenerative certified. So if you have 10 acres, then that's going to be quite costly, where you're looking at, you know, different equipment that you need. Yes, but I'll stop there. As you all know, I have a lot to say.
Well, you know, you brought up an interesting point about the funding for the Climate Smart, and what I found and what who have reached out to our organization and our farmers are predominantly white organizations that got the money. And they got a lot of money, but they needed Black farmers. And so when they applied for the grants, they reached out to our organization. They wanted us to be on the grant. I said, I don't mind being on the grant, but we've got a share in this amount of the grant. And there were a few that said, oh no, we just want to make sure the farmers get a certain amount. I said, oh no, we need to be a part of making those decisions and how much we got. And we didn't sign on to them if they didn't agree to that. But it's disheartening to find out that a lot of that money did not go to many of the Black organizations that actually needed an on the ground working with the farmers.
There's a term called BIPOC. I know that everyone has heard this term. And that's where a lot of that money is being attached, you know, to BIPOC grants, BIPOC funding, Black Indigenous People of Color. But the first letter, the first acronym in that letter is Black. And so the money is going to these white organizations, you know, and so now they have this fulfillment to find a percentage of Black farmers in order to fulfill this grant. And so when we look at that and we say no, especially if there's not a fair cut, then, you know, we say no, then they're not able to meet their grant. And what we call that is a relationship of convenience. They're not really investing in the Black farming culture or lifestyle or family. You know, they're really just trying to check a box to meet a grant.
Yes, so ma'am.
When it comes to growth and sustainability, they don't care. What matters is that the money comes in. Yes. And so if the money is coming in, here's how I want to give a personal opinion. If the money is coming in for the Black farmer, then the money should be used. Most of it should be used for the Black farmer. And so we have to create a think tank or some advocacy or unified voice to go to Capitol Hill and stand there and say, we're sick and tired of being sick and tired, and we're not taking this no more. You're getting this money, and it's not being allocated appropriately based on the Black farmer. Can I get a comment on that?
Well, since I was the last one to talk, let me just throw this right quickly. We're talking about equity, right? And so equal access, equality is saying, hey, these grants are released, and they sent out a press release and let us know that the grants are released. But when we talk about equity, equity is the intent of outreach into Black communities, not like getting the end of the tail end of the grant where there's no more money left or you got 2 weeks to fill it out in order to submit your paperwork. Equity is understanding that Black folks may not have computers, may not have the savviness to download 45 pages, may not have all these things that push them back. You know, working full-time jobs give you very limited time, you know, to research and do other things. But we're talking about equity. We're talking about they should be making sure that that a lion's share of the grant should be to retard, to slow down land loss in the African-American community, to help them advance their operations, you know, by open up markets for them, teaching them. I don't know if many of you know about terminal market prices. It's a place where the USDA has the list. If you want to know how much, you know, to charge for a case of collard greens, well, there's a commercial marketplace on the USDA where you can go to the terminal market. And then you can find out how much that case of collard greens is being sold on the market so you can compete on the market. You know, oftentimes, you know, I've met farmers and they're selling collard greens and you get 24 bunches in a case. I met a farmer about 6-7 months ago. He's selling his collard greens for $8 a case. And it's only because he's not aware of what the going market price is. So some of that is on our end to make sure that we're informed and connect with, you know, the chamber, Black Chamber of Commerce and the Better Business Bureau, and try to find out if we can get some support and have somebody watch these grants, watch these prices, and be able to assist the Black farmers with this knowledge that they need in order to compete in these markets.
Did you know that data was available freely? Now you got to search for it through the website of the USDA to get to that information. They used to give a farm report once a week here in Florida. Every week they'll tell you what the current beef price is and all of the market prices on almost any vegetable. They took that away a few years ago, along with the fact where the money was going. We have a local farmer here. He's a, you know, white family. The grandmother, the grandfather, the daughter, the grandson, the daughter-in-law, they all were getting all of these big grants from the USDA, millions of dollars every year. You know, you can't find that data anymore. And I happened to take pictures of it, of course, a few years ago when it was out, but you don't have access to that anymore. So they're hiding a lot of the data where the money's going. Now, the other last thing I wanted to add that you asked was about whether the chamber should be an advocate for the farmers. Yes, I say. But also I want to mention that a lot of that money also went to other Black organizations that had nothing to do with farming. So I'll be honest with you, I'm conflicted because they're Black and I want to see them get the money, but the money wasn't trickling down to the Black farmer either way. So that was a little frustrating to find out a political organization got millions of dollars for Black farmers and have never really done anything for Black farmers. They were a civil rights organization, to be honest. And so, you know, we're getting it from everywhere. The Black farmers are getting it from all sides.
So that takes me to, there's racism within the race. Well, you guys, I'm going to coin that phrase, okay? But I've heard that many times, that money, you know, that should be going to one Black organization, it'll go to another Black organization. So again, the accountability piece is still missing regardless. So what can we do? What can we do to put in some accountability, some checks and balances, and how do we follow up? What would you recommend?
You know, I think there should be a, go ahead, brother, go ahead.
Well, I was going to say, Dr. Delma, I would actually come with a kind of slightly different perspective of how, you know, because to me, that question goes into, well, how do we audit to know where the money went? But before the money's even getting out the door, we got to be in it to win it. And because if we're just putting energy, we only got limited resources. There's abundance of resources, but right now we're sitting with limited, right? And if we're focusing on just all the effort to really double down on, well, where did the money go? The money's already gone. That ship has sailed, water under the bridge. I think a fair amount of energy needs to be put up front, because I'm going to play back what I heard. There is a civil rights group that actually got the money and don't have anything to do with farming. But here's one thing that they did, that even when I partnered with those organizations at the state level, we had a plan in place to pretty much ensure that we checked every box and was positioned that there's no reason we shouldn't get the grant. I wasn't sitting there surprised. Some people on that team were, but with the work that we did in front of the scene and behind the scene, I was pretty confident. We gave them, you know, I always have a phrase that I say, anything coming to me, the team is bringing me something and here's a problem or whatever. My first question is, do we know what they want? Because my response is, give them what they want. That civil rights organization gave them what they want. And that's why they got that money.
Well, that's a good comment. And what you're saying is perhaps we need more assistance with the paperwork. We're going back to something that we covered earlier in this conversation. And that's where I was saying, what organizations can help the farmer? A lot of times the farmer, he knows how to farm. He can get out there and plow the field or whatever it is he have to do. But when it comes to the paperwork can be.
It's even more than the paperwork, though. It's a strategy.
Right.
Like, when you're going out to these grants, I'm getting ready to go for a touchdown. I want to make sure I got the right team on the field, i.e. the partners at that table. And then we're putting a play in place ensure that we're gonna first down. We're getting first downs. We're not even trying to put ourselves in a position to throw a Hail Mary. Like, we've got everything locked down. And then another key thing that's a thread for me on everything is relationships. We have to have the right key, like your FSA officer. You know, I go back to what Ms. Smith was talking about. And when the FSA person is saying, who sent you? You know, before I'm even walking into that office, I've already hit my network and see, hey, who know Jim down at the FSA office? I already want a call to have went to Jim before I walk in the door. So when I'm walking in the door, Jim, even though I'm this Black guy walking in, and I don't know what color, you know, it could vary the color of who already is connected to Jim. But literally, before I walk in any door, there's been a, as they say in Japan, there's always a meeting before the meeting. Mm-hmm. I never want to walk in and do a deal where this is the first, because that's transactional. We focus on building relationships.
Yeah, and I get it, and I appreciate your comment there. And I do know of farmers who have submitted. I write grants, I write proposals, certified woman-owned small business. I've seen some killer proposals, and they didn't get a thumbs up. And I've seen some proposals that were so sloppy, I wouldn't even have given them a penny, but they won it. So going to the table with a top-notch proposal or with
it's not everything.
It's not going to always get you there. We have to, I think it's been said, we got to be at the table to find out what's the new strategy. And when we find out the rules of the game, they change it. And don't tell me they don't. We can be, you know, oh, now I got it. I figured it out. This is what we need to do. And then we get there and now, oh, we got another hurdle to climb over. So I'm hoping the conversations and the information like what you just shared and all the other comments will help us pull together at the end of this program some key initiatives that we can do to form collaborative partnerships, strategic alliances, and to help the farmer in the areas where he's weak. Because no matter what we have tried, we get there and the rules change. And if the rules don't change, they just don't look at our proposal. And I'll be quiet because I'm not the expert. You guys are. I want to hear from you.
Yeah, I think you hit a key point, you know, and in terms of what could the chamber do or, you know, one of the things is like you suggested, you know, come up with a list. So someone have to do some research and track all the grants and funding that's coming out of the USDA and be ahead of it. Right. And so we're not getting the information in 30 days or in 15 days and have to submit this information. I believe that's the same throughout the country. We all get Black farmers, we get the information and the grants at a very short window to have to turn around and then submit. So I'd say first of all, research the information and then come up with a list and date that this is what's coming up. This is the date that is due and we can assist you. It'd be great if someone is able to assist them with understanding the grant, you know, and the requirements of the grant, and then assist them in writing the grant. I mean, because you're right, farmers are good farmers. We know how to farm, but, you know, and if you're working a full-time job and you're trying to farm, you may be tech savvy and know how to do that, but just don't have the time. So I think that would be, you know, one way that would be a tremendous help is to accumulate a list of resources, grants, deadlines, due dates, and have that available on the website where that's the point where the farmers go and look. You guys become, you know, the point of reference to what's available.
You know, I'm happy you brought that up. We put together a list, my firm put together a list for a communications firm for all types of bids and proposals and grants 2 years out, right? And then we go through and we filter it and we vet it and we narrow it down. And then we put together a team who can help write it. So now you're ahead of the curve. You're not getting a grant. Now you got 10 days, but you still have to work and make a living. So you can't shut down your operation to write this grant. But if we had a program in place that would let you know, hey, this is coming down the pipe, plus add things that would drop out of Washington at the last minute and be able to help you say, hey, that's tailor fit for me. I wanna go for that one. But now we got 7, 8, 10 months to write it. We're not, you know, trying to jump on the bandwagon at the last minute and you can't do your best work.
Well, yeah, and just to say, the USDA is never that organized when you have 8, 9 months.
Well, I would push back on that because every grant I've ever went after, either it came across my radar because I'm always tracking those grants, or one of my contacts would text me a link and saying, hey, have you seen this? Mm-hmm. That Climate Smart Commodities grant, it was announced in February when Bill Sack came out and said originally $1 billion, they then increased it to $3 billion. in February, that came across my radar. It was a press release that he did. And I had a meeting. I was already had a team in place, all the organizations that are mentioned, academic and state. In that meeting, I said to the team, hey, did y'all see this? We need to go after this grant. We had till June to submit that grant. We then still working on, because we were at the time doing a feasibility study on hemp, industrial hemp in, for the state of Tennessee that was paid for by the Department of Agriculture. And that same, and I had all the resources I needed. And I said, hey, other than loss of sleep, because there was pushback from the professors that was at the table saying, I'm doing this, I got this research. I said, outside of losing some sleep, what do we got to lose to go get $5 million? Like, literally. And they agreed. But it was right there at the end. We spent about a week of, I don't think anybody got any sleep. But we did have a larger window. And the key call out there is, I got a little spreadsheet right now of EPA and DOE grants that fit things that I can pursue. And even when I come to pursuing something, I'm never looking at it from the, especially with hemp, to use hemp as an example. There's nothing in that smart commodities grant, climate smart commodities grant, that said, yeah, we're wanting to do hemp projects. No, what they was focused on was carbon sequestration, right? Well, guess what? Hemp can do that. And so we tailored, hemp was just a tool that we're using. But back to what I said, I give them what they want. What are you saying you want? Oh, well, I got something. This is why what I got fits that bucket, literally. So I'm never necessarily even looking for hemp grants, because if I go out there and search for hemp grants, nothing's coming up. I look at, okay, here are the attributes and benefits of hemp. How can we get in? You know, just even call out a group, Black group out of Baltimore. It's a business accelerator, Intravation. If you look up Intravation LLC, you'll see where them along with the Hemp Building Institute was just awarded $6.2 million from EPA. That group up in Maryland, it's a Black group.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've heard of them.
And here's the beautiful thing about that grant, though. These guys are focused on hemp. EPA just awarded them $6.2 million to come up with the calculation for how to verify when we're doing these hemp projects, whether it's building or whatever, how will it capture carbon? What's the calculation that the government will use? They're getting $6.2 million over 5 years to figure that out.
Well, you know, a member of the chamber board posted an article, and the title of it is, this was just yesterday, I think, Georgia Hemp Law Disrupting the Small Business. Because you mentioned hemp, so I thought this was an appropriate time to throw that article in there. What's your thoughts?
Well, actually, the U.S. Hemp Roundtable is working with the state legislators on that to get some changes to that. That's, mm-hmm. If you go out to hempsupporter.com, you'll see all the states that we're active in, and Georgia is one of those states right now. We just defeated the bill in California, which where the marijuana industry was pushing to pull hemp in up underneath the cannabis regulation, which would basically kill all businesses and farmers, because you would need to be in the licensed cannabis program just to have hemp products in the market, which is crazy because hemp is on the whole USDA separate bill that said, no, it's legal. I don't have all the overhead and regulations that marijuana does, but we just killed that bill in Georgia, plus a few other states out there, is active work is being done right now.
Yeah, they tried that in Florida last session, and it was defeated.
Well, it was us paying for the lobbyists on the ground in Florida to get that done.
Yep, thank you.
I was on those calls.
I got a question for all of you. If I'm 19 years old I've graduated high school, 18 or 19. Why should I go into farming? And I love my iPhone and artificial intelligence. Why should I go into farming?
This is one of the most exciting times to be in farming, I think. They're getting prices higher than ever they've been in the past. And the technology now in farming is fantastic. Like you said, artificial intelligence, precision farming, drones. Our organization just signed an MOU with a company called Alpha Drones, whereby we're going to be certifying farmers how to go out and start a business whereby they're using drones in agriculture. We will train them, certify them, and if they want to, they can actually go in and get a full pilot's license because the training for those drones can be utilized that way. Also, the drones themselves are, you know, they're doing spraying of fields, they're doing surveying, all of these things. And these are huge drones. They look like mini planes. That's how big they are. And part of this organization will be doing is that initially the farmers, once they get the training, we will loan out the equipment for them. So we're giving them an opportunity to not only get the training for it, we're also giving them an opportunity to utilize the equipment for a year till they get their business running and can afford their own drones. But I would tell the young farmer, this is an exciting time. It's not just about being out in the fields. It's also being behind the computer, economics. There's so many areas, engineering. There's so many things that you can do now with the technology that we have, and this future in farming is just fantastic.
You know, I would add to that, and I'm going to go at the macro level first, call out a few points that I'm sure everybody's seen, and the social media has one perspective, you know, either it's good or bad. Bill Gates is buying up farmland. I'm sure y'all have seen that. Like millions and millions. Okay, you know, they always told me to follow the money. And then in hockey, they say go not where the puck is at, but where the puck is going. If you see just that one trend and ask the question, why is Bill Gates buying up all his farmland? That's first, right? That's the first question. When I saw it, I'm like, hold on, what's going on? But then another perspective to drop on you just to think on, ponder over. And it's just my take on what I see as a trend that's happening. Everyone is aware of cycles. You know, we've been hearing about these 100-year floods, right? That's a cycle where you expect a shift, something to happen. Right now, I believe that we are in, from a business environment, economics perspective, we're in a 100-year cycle. If you go back 100 years ago, and I use the hemp industry as the example. If I go back 100 years ago, it was when the industrialized society was being built out. And by the 1960s, we had smokestacks from Detroit to LA, right? And smog was prevalent everywhere. That was a cycle because literally, if you look at 1902-3, if you'd have been on Times Square in New York, you'd have seen nothing but horses and buggies. But by 1912, 1913, same block in Midtown Manhattan would have been nothing but Malty Fords, a 10-year shift. But in that shift, we went to an industrialized society. Now, the hemp industry. A 100 years ago, hemp was king. Hemp was still being manufactured and put into products, ships, etc. We're now what I like to call, we're moving into a plant-based technology. And hemp is playing a role in that, just to make you aware. It's not public, but I'm open to at least share it. But we hadn't published anything on this yet, nor any articles. But in March of this year, Department of Energy awarded Oak Ridge National Laboratory and Hemp Alliance of Tennessee $500,000. And what we're focused on right now is developing automotive parts using hemp. And that's both structural and non-structural. And the idea that I'm presenting is not new. If you're driving any European automotive vehicle, whether it's Mercedes-Benz, BMW, or Volkswagen right now, they're already in those cars driving in the United States on our roads has hemp composite in those vehicles. The only difference is all that hemp is grown in Europe and those parts are manufactured in France and then shipped to South Carolina, right? And everybody who's from South Carolina going to that BMW plant, it's being flown in. Hemp is being flown in to be assembled in those cars. If it's Mercedes-Benz, it's Alabama, the South. And then if it's Volkswagen, it's Chattanooga, Tennessee. And so what I did a year ago was presented to our Economic and Development Commissioner a proposal of pretty much saying, this is happening, sir. Why aren't we growing that hemp in the state of Tennessee, manufacturing as it fits both of our Republican governor's top two focus and agenda is farmers and rural development. Every time he's doing his annual address, those are the top two key points. And I walked in that office saying, I got an opportunity here for us to grow and create manufacturing in rural areas to manufacture and produce parts, because we're in the automotive capital of the world now. If you look at, you know, cars aren't really made in Detroit anymore. It's in the states, all from North Carolina, you name it, it's the South. And so that's an opportunity, and that's where I go with plant-based technology. That's farming.
Okay, let's go back to the panel. The audience want to hear the comments from Dr. Jackson, Handy, and Amon. Can you chime in?
Could you just repeat the question so I understand?
He was talking about hemp, but we've covered quite a bit. And you're a young farmer. I know we've had an overview on why a young person should go into farming, and you are a young person. So can you add to what's been said, which I really like the technology piece that came from Dr. Wilson. Can you add your comments to that? Why should a young person go into farming? The average age of the farmer today is 57.5 years old. So how are we gonna encourage young people to go into farming?
We could go down to the basics of how children love animals. We go down that road and say, well, what animal do you like on the farm? Then we could go down to, well, let's try to take care of this animal now. How much food does that animal need? How much is it? And teach them how to really go down that aspect and do husbandry or poultry. I don't know much about hemp, so I can't really say anything about that, but that's how I was really raised and taught into farming. Once I found out my favorite animal in the farm, I started taking care of that animal. Then I learned about another animal, and I learned about another animal. And then I learned about plants, fruits, and vegetables, and how it actually helps my body. So now we're going into science. And now it's becoming a school for young farmers like myself. So now you don't even need the schools, and you could just homeschool your kids. And now, it goes deep for me, actually.
I like that. So you're saying, find young people who like being outdoors, or those mm-hmm. who like animals and who want to be outside doing things with their hands, or I don't know, she talked about technology there. So that would be one way to attract some of the younger people into farming.
Yes.
I just want to tell you about one of our success stories here in California. We all know that it's difficult to get the youth inspired, to not just be farmers, to work in agriculture. That's like a bigger term, not just a farmer, but in the agriculture industry. And this one particular farmer when I met him, he was farming by himself. He had 15 acres, but he was only farming on 2 acres and working a full-time job. And so once he became a member of Farms to Grow, we began to talk to him about some of our programs. And he says, wow, if this could work out, then I can retire early. And I said, wow, retire early. So come to find out, he did retire. He decided to retire in February, Black History Month, but he retired early. The point of the story is that he's in our wholesale distribution, selling to hospitals and universities. And so now he's not grown on 2 acres, he's grown on all 15 acres. And his son and his daughter didn't want anything to do with the land. In fact, what's really sad, we got 220 acres up north, and like most Black farmers, their kids don't want anything to do with it. So, you know, this farmland will be given to someone else, be sold to someone else, not in a trust, not, you know, so many other things that could happen, but the children don't want anything to do with it. But back to this other farmer who's experienced a huge measure of success, his son and his daughter and his wife, who didn't want anything to do, they were just kind of standing back watching him. But now that they see that nobody's inspired by watching a business operate in red, nobody, you know? And so now you have a business that moved its way out of red, operating in black, generating revenue. And I said to him, I said, your son, how much is your son getting paid an hour? And he said, I think he's getting paid like $20 an hour. I said, offer him $22 an hour to come back to the land. So now he's making enough money on his land where the family, the son has come back, the daughter has come back, his wife is doing admin. So he's building this whole ecosystem. So I'm saying all this to say, we motivate the kids. I love his answer. I love the other brother's answer, but the biggest motivation is to see a successful business and then see that child see that successful business and see that they can see that as a viable income for themselves. So we go back to our original question, how do we reduce land loss? How do we sustain the farms? How do we bring people back to the land, the value of the land, the love of the land, the relationship, the connection? We've said it all. But how do we get them back? We get them back by making sure these farms are successful, you know, in marketplace and grants and foundations. I think one of the things that we solved here today, if your company or the Better Business Bureau can, or the chamber can come up with this list that would help Black farmers, and they just say, well, you just go here when you're looking for funding, come right here, you know, and that would be one of the biggest sources. But Black, you know, young kids, they need to see that their fathers and their mothers and their families are making money and revenue off the land.
Okay, so that makes sense. You're saying, you know, when they see a successful example of farming, that can help them to see how rewarding it can be. I like that.
It could, but also one problem with that is my generation does not like to do a lot of work at all.
Thank you for your honesty. Let me stop right there. We got a young person out here telling the full truth. But we still love y'all.
I have friends that call me all the time saying, why do I not be on the phone a lot? And some of my friends actually come to the farm, work at least for 30 minutes, not even a whole hour, 30 minutes. And then they realize on why I'm not on the phone all the time. Once they see how much work you had to put in just to even make that success, that type of success, they won't want to do all that. They'll want their parents to do it, and then they'll hop into that. So even though you would want them to see the success and then they'll be able to work on it, what about before? Because you won't want to do all that work, and now your back is hurting, and they're taking all the stuff that you've made for even though it was for your family, but also yourself. So how would you incorporate the kids in that way then, after that, or before that? I mean,
well, you know, one of the things that you mentioned, I'm glad, is that farming without modern technology is very difficult work. I look at how I first learned how to farm on 300 foot rows, you know, where there was no transplanter. You had to actually manually, you know, plant, which is very, very time consuming. But when you look at a transplanter where you can sit one or two people on a seat and you put your everything up on a tray and then bam, 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 and it reduces the time. So that's why the funding piece is important to modernize the equipment that's on site, because farming does not have to be as hard as our ancestors had to work. There are different equipment and different ways now where some of that can be reduced. But you're right, I have encountered the younger generation where they don't want to do any labor. But someone else mentioned there are different jobs in the agriculture industry that doesn't require the physical labor, but it's still going to require time invested. You know, it could be social media, you know, somebody running the business social media account and their website and, you know, and writing, doing communication, that still requires some level of investment, and that we have to begin to retrain the youth. No, it's not okay to be lazy. That's not okay. That's home training. You know, it's not okay to be lazy. You know, we have to work, you know, and it's misleading to believe that, you know, that you could just get away with doing the minimum.
Yeah, you bring up an excellent point. I want to go to Dr. Jackson on this next. We got about two more questions, then we're going to have rapid fire, and then we'll go to the floor. Dr. Jackson, talk to me about automation on the farm, because that's exactly where Dr. Smith just took me.
Yes. You know, one of the things that, you know, that I'm very much focused on is those alternative crops that are utilized in the development of pharmaceuticals, and also bringing innovation, Internet of Things, robotics to farming. But the rate limiting step associated with that is what was brought up earlier when we began, was capital. I mean, you can, you know, the grants are fine, but you tend to find that in that space, it's heavily saturated, and the larger institutes are going to get said grants. And then when you start talking about innovation and technology, there's a plethora of companies out there that'll sell you a drone, but that drone is worth $200,000. So how do you make that practical for the small farmer? So I think the opportunity is there, but it's going to have to be a situation that one of the members on the call said, creating your own market. One of the things at VeriFarm, we have technology, testing technology, robotics, et cetera. And we like to partner with entities and farms to figure out, okay, if you're applying for a climate smart initiative, okay, you need to show some sort of innovation technology to move yourself up the chain. And we can provide that. Even though you haven't paid us anything, it's an opportunity for us to create an alliance in order to help you. In addition, if your crops are tied into alternative crops utilized for pharmaceuticals, we're partnered with the Institutes of the Texas Medical Center. So if this is a crop that can be utilized for the development of drugs for cancer, childhood epilepsy, you know, we can go to any of the expert institutions and give you that association as well. So I think it has to be planned out, but I think the opportunity is huge, because if you can establish yourself with that innovative piece to your operation, you can then, one, of course, apply for grants, but two, if you have an association or a partnership or a relationship with a private bank or a large insurance company or a private office, you could use said contract to request a line of credit or something of that nature. You know, I've written grants. I'm a traditionally trained scientist. I understand that whole situation. But oftentimes, one of the things that I saw, you know, I've trained at Yale, went to HBCUs, the whole thing. You know, if you're not in the club, you don't really get looked at. Even if you have a great idea, you have to be in the club. I served on panels where I reviewed grants, and usually the person or the senior individual that's been in the game for a while that applied for the grant, he knows everybody on the panel and they know his work. And oftentimes the smaller or useful individual that may have the most novel idea, either they got triaged early because they didn't write a certain thing right, and that's, you know, obviously growing pains and learning how to write grants, or maybe everybody in the review panel or the review group didn't really understand the novelty of said idea. So you're going to have a plan. You're going to have to think outside the box. There's a lot of issues here. Everybody's brought up a lot of great ideas, a lot of great things that they're doing personally. But if you want to really reach down to that small farmer who wants to get in the game to reach those high ROIs, you're going to have to create that pipeline that allows them, because they're not going to have the money, they're not going to have the $1 million, they're not going to have the $10 million. We got to be honest with ourselves. But how can you create the pipelines to whereas, okay, yes, we can build an alliance, a collaboration where we can go in together, whether you're writing for a grant or whether you're looking to be a part of a program or you want to establish something new for what your alternative crop or whatever it is. Those are the ways you can kind of get around and move yourself into a space where you can now start to garner those revenues. Like I said, with my company, we recognize this early on that the smaller farmer, he's not going to be able, he doesn't have the resources of a Philip Morris to have 5,000 hectares of cannabis or hemp. He or she don't have the resources to really use that type of leverage. They're going to have a partner that's in that space, that's in that area, especially my area of pharmaceuticals, biopharmaceuticals, that can collaborate with them to move them forward and be okay with not getting paid from them, but say, hey, we will work with you to find how can this be practical in your operation. So from that point of view, I think the opportunity is huge for the young farmer. I think that we are witnessing a transformation of wealth right now in this country. And farming is going to be, especially sustainable farming, is going to be the cornerstone in the future. And it's going to be tied into Internet of Things, robotics from sensors, not just GPS, but I'm talking actual robotics in the field, monitoring the soil, monitoring the weather, being able to carry out operations, whereas you don't need 30 workers out there in the field. You may only need 10 managing the robots. So the opportunity is huge, but there's still that major variable of capital. And a grant is fine. I like grants, but that is an incredibly saturated area, to whereas major universities will get the grants. And then you come to find out that those universities don't really pay the smaller farmer what they're supposed to And I'm sure there's farmers on this call that can elaborate and testify to the fact that they literally have to fight to go get the funding that they were a part of that the larger institute got. So the opportunity is huge, but your planning as far as capital, all of these things need to be seriously drawn out. And you know, the relying on grants are great, but let me tell you, that is a game that only those who are really tied into the situation. I mean, you got 1 million people applying for 10 grants. I mean, you know.
Yeah.
So, that's not a situation. You have to have the capital. You have to have the planning. You have to have alliances that's going to have the resources that's going to give you the capability to really move your operation forward.
Okay. Thank you so much. That was some good information.
Hey, Dr. O'Donnell.
Yes.
I was wondering if I could just add a real quick solution.
Yeah, because we're short for time and we got to wrap up. So you got to make it very short, please.
Yeah. Give me 30 seconds. I have a relationship with a venture capitalist group out of Michigan, Ann Arbor, Michigan. They have about $650 million assets under management. What their focus is on is developing cooperatives amongst farm groups. And so anyone on the call that is, one, done everything that Mr. Jackson said as far as having a plan in place, et cetera, if you feel free to reach out to me. If you got a collective group of farmers where you're one, because what their whole proposition is that they will literally come in and acquire the land on your behalf. You're basically within 10-year pay off the loan, and they help set up the infrastructure, work with the market and the whole nine to get you profitable, basically. So anyone that's interested, please feel free to reach out to me. And then it's always great to see my mentor and friend, Cheryl Murtaugh, on any call. That's all I got.
Thank you. We're going to wrap up now. So, and the last comment I'll make is that the state of Georgia is investing lots and lots of revenue in rural areas. And I've never seen a farm in the heart of the city yet. So just something to think about. So we've talked about access to capital. We've talked about technology and innovation. We've talked about the youth and farming. We talked about strategic partnerships. We touched on racism, accountability, transparency, and of course, a major decrease in Black farmers in the past 5 years. Those are some of the subjects that we have so many people who have had their hands up. So, but before I go to the floor, I need y'all to take only 20 seconds, 20 to 30 seconds, please. And just give one thing that this organization, the chamber who is hosting this event, one thing you think that they can do to help the Black farmer and make it short. We've already heard the details. Just tell us one thing and we're going to be taking note of that. We got all the chamber executive leadership on the call. This is the best place to tell it.
A grant resource database. I keep repeating that. That would be my number one.
I agree with that, either a resource database and also having resources there that include funding aspects.
I would have to say a training institution where farmers can have a process of getting trained on certain aspects when it comes to marketing.
Donations or finding a way to help other farmers in certain aspects that they need.
Next.
My call out would be for farmers to join organizations like the Black Air, you know, the Atlanta Black Chamber, because organizations like this need funding to be able to do the great work.
I think there's one more I missed.
Yes, I think that all the points are hitting exactly on, but definitely have a plan. And you know, there are several farmers on here that we have worked and collaborated with. Your plan is going to be your key to get past those hard times. So have your plan, have your funding in place, your accounts, your legal. Those are going to be critical for you to survive.
Thank you. Did I get everybody? I don't think I missed anyone, but if I did, speak now. Okay, if someone can mute, we're getting a little bit of noise in the background. And so now we're going to go to the floor. I see we got hands up. Is someone on my team able to help with the Q&A? Okay, so the first one, you guys, please, we got about 15 minutes for Q&A, but if your question is 5 minutes, keep in mind, no one else may be able to ask a question. So I'm just asking that you make your questions clear and short and succinct so that the panel will get about 45 seconds to a minute to answer your question. We'll start with Tanya Winbush. Tanya, can you unmute?
Yes, I can unmute. Thank you so much for what you all doing, but just to ask the question, I am considering with my family property, which I am turning back into a farm, long history, eminent domain has come through, and I am considering doing a conservatory trust. I haven't heard it really talked about tonight, but I just would love your thoughts on doing a conservatory trust on the property. And also, my other question real quick is there any resource for, and I guess this is goes to Mr. Jackson, who's on the panel, for patents, like if I have a patent and I'm having a hard time getting it approved, and this is like the third time, and I feel like the lawyer that I have is not really doing a good job, and they're just taking a lot of money. Is there someone that is a good resource for Black people that are trying to get in patents for, you know, pharmaceutical type things? And that's it. Thank you.
Well, let me answer that last question first. So the patent process, of course, you know, I would like to say it's hell on earth. Excuse my French. You have to have a high-powered attorney or a law firm once you embark on that. The problem with smaller firms is that when you have to do a justification, you know, that's going to eat into legal hours and run up the bill. So you could spend 2 years trying to get a patent across the finish line. You can email me and we can discuss offline, because you can go anywhere from $200,000 to $2 million trying to bring a patent all the way through. And it all depends on several factors. One factor, I know a lot of people, there's commercials out there for inventors and all these things. Well, you really don't want to use that necessarily, that type of service. I mean, you could, but you know, the problem there is you are the one that knows your technology. So it's going to take you to actually teach your lawyer, teach the legal, in order for them to argue the point with the patent office. And then if there's any justifications or any questions that come back, you again are going to have to teach legal to put together the correct argument. You're going to have to need, from my experience, and that's over 50 patents, you're going to need, one, a smaller attorney, but two, you're going to need that $1,000, $1,500 an hour attorney as well. And then, you know, you're going to have to be able to negotiate a fee to the point where, okay, up front, let's work till we get to the end of it and kind of pull back on some of those fees. And that's going to take a skill set as well in talking to them. But when you're dealing with the patent office, you could spend a lot of money trying to get a patent. You may get it submitted, but to get a patent actually approved and awarded, it can take millions of dollars. So if you need to talk, I put my information up there. If you want to shoot me an email and I can speak to you on this offline, because that's a long conversation in and of itself. And I'll let somebody answer your first question. Thank you.
Okay, we're gonna go to Joe James. You wanna unmute and ask your question?
And I just wanna make a comment.
Go ahead, Mr. James.
I'd like to make a comment. I am a climate tech entrepreneur, and I have a patented process by which we plant very fast and large growing crops that capture lots of CO2. And then we convert the plant material into a variety of bioproducts. What my comment is that I hope that Black farmers will also consider, and some already are, especially the hemp guys, additional non-traditional ways of using farming to solve present day problems like climate change, and to create a situation where you can participate in a bioeconomy and create jobs in rural communities, converting plant material into products. That's what we do. And I put my information in the link. And if anybody's interested, I'd be glad to talk to them.
Thank you for your comment, Mr. James. Make sure your information is posted. Let's go to Warren Russell. Can you unmute and ask your brief question? Okay, we'll come back to you, Mr. Russell. Attorney Powell, can you unmute and ask your question?
Yes, hi everyone. First of all, I just want to say what a great session. I love the coalition build that's happening here. That's the way forward, is really working together as a coalition, building resources. As mentioned in the chat, I'm a cannabis agricultural dietary supplement trade and psychedelics attorney. I've worked with Dr. Wilson. I've worked with Fred Cawthorn on a number of projects. I just want to respond to a couple things that came up on the call. One, with regards to, you know, the assistance to help with paperwork so that we can get grants and get our fair share of these grants that are available. I've always wanted to work with organizations to engage our historically Black colleges and universities that have law school programs. Law school students, you know, we talk about how do we get, you know, young people to be interested in farming. Not only do we need to have young people interested in farming, we need to have young people interested in being lawyers for farmers, being accountants for farmers, being grant writers for farmers. So happy to support the development of programs, working with law school. I have good relationships with HBCU law schools, developing that program so you have that support and they get to learn and maybe fall in love with supporting farmers as well. Also with the coalition building that's happening here, I definitely encourage you to attend, you know, Congressional Black Caucus that's coming up in the next couple of weeks as a coalition, wearing green as, you know, a constituency of farmers. So see if you know, even if it happens electronically, we can coordinate those types of efforts where we go in places together as a coalition across multiple states in our green. I wear green all the time because I'm a cannabis attorney and ag attorney, just so that we can get that support. Also NASDA, the National Association of State Departments of Agriculture, the same thing. We should be planning ahead for their leadership summit in February. We should go together as a coalition. And my final comment is, as we're pulling resources, know you get what you pay for. So a lot of times we're saying, which organization does this? Which organization does that? If you need lawyers, get lawyers and pay lawyers, but negotiate the best possible pricing so that you're getting flat rates for things and you know exactly what to expect. So congratulations again on a really great event. Thank you, Henry, for the invitation. I wanna see more from this group. I can't wait to support as a farmer myself, but also as part of the Black community. Well done, and let's keep this going beyond this call. Give thanks.
Thank you. Thank you so much for that comment. Is Mr. Morrison still on the call? Mr. Morrison, are you there? Okay, we'll come back to you. Nakima Hemingway, your brief question, please.
Thank you. Actually, I have a comment. My name is Nikita Hemingway. I was the 2022 Democratic nominee for Commissioner of Agriculture for the state of Georgia. But most importantly, I'm a fifth generation farmer. And my husband and I grow a commodity that is not commonly recognized in agriculture, and that is cut flowers. There were several comments that were made, but first and foremost, I want to thank you guys for a phenomenal panel. I thought the information was very insightful. There were a lot of good points, and there are just a few things I want to touch up on. There was a mention of how can we improve the amount of farm ownership that is owned by Black families. And the first place that we need to start is by creating a succession plan. Too often I've traveled the state and I get accompanied by a host of women who bring this question. My husband or my father ran this farm, and now that person has passed and we're left trying to build this. This is something that you shouldn't wait till the last minute to do, creating a succession plan now so that the transfer of ownership for your estate is already set up in motion. A good way of doing that is establishing a trust. When you put things in a trust and you add beneficiaries, then you're not subject to probate and taxation that can be overwhelming. So that's very important. When we talk about attracting young people to the space of agriculture, meet them where they're at. There is so much in this space that is very desirable, but oftentimes the conversation that we're having and what we're trying to appeal to, it doesn't resonate. But when you show them that there is a place for them in this space, how you can be creative, how you can employ the very skills that you're using to run modern day technology in this space, I believe that that can be impactful. And then the other thing that really concerns me is that we've shifted the conversation so much in the conversations about African-American farmers, and we rely heavily on the grants that we're not getting, the grants that we want. And the reality is that even when you get grants, there are expectations, performance expectations that accompany those grants. We got to start with the fundamentals and the basics. There are people right now who've never done agriculture in their life, and they're making $100,000, $200,000 on a platform like Etsy just selling plants. We've got to figure out ways to use the resources we currently have to be profitable. The other thing is you got to get your paperwork in order. A lot of farmers haven't even done their taxes for 2-3 years. Don't wait until the opportunity presents itself. Be prepared. So when those grants come up, half of the work is already done. And the most important part is we got to take accountability, because everything is not about racism. We cannot sue the USDA for grants we're not getting if we're not applying for them. The only way you track disenfranchisement is if we're actively participating in the process. So even if you know you may not get the grant this time, apply for the grant anyway. Because when we have an active record and we can say, well, we had 10,000 Black farmers apply for these grants and you're only approved 0.5% of them, that's our case right there. But when we're not even applying for those, we don't have a case. And most importantly, every state, those census, they're voluntary participation. So please, please find out. It's usually the university that has the grant, like here in Georgia, it's UGA. Contact them. If you don't know how to find the information on the website, call them, contact them, find out about the different censuses that are happening. Make sure you add your information, because that's the only way that we're going to continue to be a part of the conversation and that we're constantly seen. So thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Ms. Hemingway. I hope that you join us at the next event. I will make sure we keep in touch with you. We got time for two short questions, and then we got to do our closing remarks. I see two hands. I'm going to try to grab them, but if you have a question, this is for Q&A. We'll start with Dante Pickett. Please make it brief, and then we'll go to BG Sean Harris right after that.
Yes, this will be very quick. I'm at work, so I just want to be, is there a way I can rewatch this video and have access to all the comments and information and contact information to everybody in the panel? Because I was unable to be able to jot down everybody's information or hear everything clearly. So I just want to be able to, when I have the time, to be able to go through and watch everything and be able to receive all the information.
Yes. It will be on the chamber's website or on their Facebook page. And if not, make sure you put your information in the chat, because everybody who's putting their information in the chat will do a follow-up. Thank you. And at that time, we can make sure you get the information. So make sure all your information is in the chat. And thank you for being on board with us. Let's go to BJ.
Hey, how you doing? This is Sean Harris. I'm a fourth generation farmer here in Northwest Georgia. Was born and raised down there in Southwest Georgia, Blakely, Georgia. First of all, I want to thank Mr. Kennedy for inviting me. The other piece, I just wanted to listen tonight because I'm actually running for Congress. I'm running against Marjorie Taylor Greene, and I wanted to make sure that I understood what was going on with Black farmers. Even though I'm a Black farmer, we all got our own story. So I just want to say thank you. I'm going to always listen in. And when I get to Congress, I'm going to make sure we continue to open up some doors for all of us. Have a great night.
Thank you. Well, we've given you an earful tonight.
Yes, ma'am.
And before I do the last minute closing remarks, are there any other candidates who are still on the call who'd like to introduce yourself and say the office you're running for? Any candidates or elected officials still on the line? Okay. I want to thank the National Association of Black Women in Construction for all of your support. I want to thank I can't say enough about the panel. Every time we have this event, I learn so much. I know it was a lot of time and effort for you guys who are extremely busy, but the chamber, as well as myself, would like to sincerely thank you so much for sharing your expertise with us. We will be having a follow-up to this one. So if you are interested in being on the panel or getting more information about the next event, make sure all your information, your contact is listed in the chat. That's the only way we'll be able to follow up with you. So we want to thank any of our other partners and supporters, any of our sponsors. Definitely want to turn it back over to, if they're still on the call, I'd like for Melvin Coleman and Marquis Tate to provide us with some closing remarks officially from the chamber.
Dr. Diane, this is Lynette. There was a gentleman in the beginning, Brian Harrison, that you told he was going to get to at the end. I didn't know if you had a chance.
I think I called his name. Is he still on the line? I'd like to get his question or his comment.
I am.
Okay, Mr. Harrison. I thought I called, maybe I mispronounced it, but I think I asked for Morrison and it's Harrison. Uh-huh. I apologize.
Okay. Well, listen, I'm not going to belabor the point, but thank God for you guys and for what you're attempting to do. So let us just continue to move forward with this effort. And thank you. And I appreciate the opportunity just to be involved in a great opportunity.
Mr. Harrison, we want to thank you for being a farmer. We know we need more. We need more Blacks farming, but we also know when we get them there, we need to support and uplift them and make sure we're doing everything we can to help them get access to the tools and resources that they need. So thank you for staying online and for being one of our participants this evening. You guys, I know I still see a lot of hands, but this was a 2-hour program, but don't worry, you can still post your question in the chat and we will follow up and send that question to the panel and the panel will respond back to you direct. So please don't, it's 4 minutes after 8. This was a 2-hour program. Every time we give this program, we just don't have enough time. So I think the next one, we're going to try to do it in a physical venue and maybe make it a 2.5 or 3-hour program and break it up so that everybody will have enough time to get their questions in. I'd like to turn it back over to Melvin Coleman or Marquis Tate if they're still on the line.
Good. Powerful. I mean, every time we talk about this topic, it's a powerful experience. So, Dr. Adoma, I agree with you in person. And if we get the right venue, we may be able to make it a four-hour experience with maybe a couple of, whether it's breakout sessions or fireside chats and panels, you know, do it right. It deserves that type of attention. So thank you to everyone that came through this evening, and let's move this conversation forward and really get a strategy around collectively taking action to get the justice that we know we deserve in this historic arena for us, agriculture. Marquis, you got any closing remarks, brother?
Yes, ditto everything you said, Melvin. This is definitely a great conversation. Thanks to the panelists, our expert panelists. You did a great job in giving out some appropriate information. We have to move this conversation forward. As Melvin said, we got to work strategically in this area. Dr. Adoma, I think we talked earlier today, this is a third or fourth event. It's an annual event, but we have to do this more often. So I'm going to be talking with Melvin, Dr. Adoma, and the rest of our leaders in the chamber and how we can continue to move this forward. You heard me talk a lot about the history of Black farmers, and it's not so much great history. We have to be very strong on the advocacy side, and we have to change laws at the public policy level to really make things happen for Black farmers. Due to the historical things that have happened to Black farmers over the years, there's a lot of notes that I've taken tonight from Grant Resource Center, data, training, access to capital. That's definitely the major piece. And we've actually, I think all the panelists have mentioned access to capital, and whether that's grant funding, which Dr. Jackson talked a lot about that, and it's not a lot of funding there. Thank you for Mr. Cawthorn for your information on a money that's out there and opportunities for us. So, hey, this was a great conversation tonight. We have to move this forward to the next level, not only having this on an annual basis, Dr. Adoma and Melvin, but having this on an ongoing basis, because this is a very important. As I mentioned earlier, this is the original. The Black farmer is the original entrepreneur in our community, and we have to move things forward in this area. So thanks a lot, panelists. I know real quick, I did see Representative Jenkins on the line. I saw Mayor Dr. Beverly Jones. Thank you for attending. Kenya from USDA. Since I know you put some good information in the chat, Kenya, thanks a lot for coming in. I know Dr. Calvin Ellison, our VP of Community Affairs, is in also. So thank you, everyone, for coming in. I really appreciate it. And I'll put my information in the chat also.
Marquis?
Yeah, he muted himself towards the end.
Okay. Yeah, make sure he brings in. Go ahead. Hey, I just want to remind you to make sure you let Henry say a few words. He just texted me. The chair of the Agriculture Committee.
Go ahead, brother. You got the floor.
I want to thank the chamber and the panelists and the people on the call, because there were so many people on the call that we invited. We have to expand this because we had, as Marky said, the USDA was on the call. So they was listening to your guys' concern, and they put some information in the chat, which Ms. Kenya, she really gives some good information to the farmers. So again, we have to continue this conversation. We will try to reach out to everyone if you put a question in the chat room. We won't do a consultation, but we will try to either answer your question or send you in the right direction for your answer. And again, thanks everyone for your time in the chamber for having this event.
And now we'll go back to Melvin and Marquis for the final word.
Well, great event. And we're gonna talk about what the future looks like in terms of activities and things. You know, talking about having an initiative within our organization that is focused on this so that we do have more touches throughout the year. And with that, you know, we are good and done, and we're glad that you were here to be a part of the experience. Thank you so much.
Thanks, everybody. Bye, Melvin. Bye, everybody.
Bye-bye. Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
Good night.
Thanks, everyone. Good night.
What a blessing. What a blessing.
Thank you all for showing up.
What a blessing.
Good night, everyone. God bless.
God bless. Happy holidays. Be safe.